Let's now talk to Dr. Aurora Parong, the co-chairperson of the Philippine Coalition for the ICC. She's also the vice chairperson of Amnesty International Philippines. Good morning, Doc Al. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Mike, and good morning, Nikki. Thank you for inviting us.
All right, Dr. Al, the president now categorically saying the Philippines won't rejoin the International Criminal Court. Were you still surprised? Because he did say before that the Philippines will not cooperate with the ICC.
It's not really a surprise to us, because during the campaign, the president has already said that there will be no cooperation, and the other side of the possible rejoining, it's not really expected.
Mm-hmm. Right. But the president did meet with the UN resident ambassador Gustavo Gonzalez in June this year, where he promised he will ensure a high level of accountability for human rights violations in the country. So is refusing to cooperate and rejoin the ICC consistent with that statement?
You know, that statement of the UN resident coordinator really gave us a small hope, you know, that there would be some changes in the new government. But now we see that it's not in line with having a higher level of accountability in the country. If you're not rejoining the ICC and you are rejecting the continuation of a possible investigation, of course, they have not spoken yet, because they are asked by the ICC pretrial chamber to give their views on the prosecutor's request to continue the investigations now.
Mm-hmm. And to what extent do you think was the president's stand on this issue influenced by that meeting last week with top legal officials in his cabinet? At least two of them, Solicitor General Minardo Guevara and Attorney Harry Roque, previously served under the administration of former President Rodrigo Duterte, and they maintain that same position. We have a working justice system, therefore the ICC should not interfere.
Yeah, I think that's also influenced by former Secretary Guevara, who is now our sole gem. But I think that has been the position already of President Marcos, because during his campaign, he did say that they will not be cooperating. He even said that the ICC personnel can only be allowed here in the Philippines as tourists, not as investigators.
Mm-hmm. And Justice Secretary Boying Rimulya also adopted this view. But during the start of this administration, did you have any hope that with the new Justice Secretary, somehow the administration would adopt a different view?
Yes, we did. You know, that statement that was given to the UN resident coordinator gave us a small possible opening, you know. Mm-hmm. But like we said earlier in our statement, we had made recommendations, in fact, to the Philippine government, not only to rejoin the ICC, because if you say that you will pursue the campaign against drugs within the rule of law and with human rights considerations, as well as looking at prevention, strengthening the prevention aspect, as well as saying that you will have a high level of accountability during this administration, that was some opening that we had hoped would be taken by the president seriously. But now, the statements that he has said, there's no need for an ICC investigations, because there is investigation and the courts are functioning. But you know, the problem is, first, there had not been adequate investigations. Not every one of those who were killed were autopsied. There's that findings of Dr. Raquel Fortun, a forensic scientist who was able to get hold of exhumed bodies of 46 people killed. And she found that there is even faking of death certificates. Seven people who are said to have died of natural cause like sepsis, pneumonia, or hypertension were found to have either bullets inside the body or bullet wounds in the skull. So this forensic investigation was not even, I did not see anything in the news that the Philippine government got interested to look into these findings of Dr. Fortun, because that would have been one action, concrete action, that will show that they're really investigating seriously these crimes against humanity of murder. So this is really a letdown for all of us. And most importantly, I think, for the families of the victims of the killings during the war on drugs. And, the prosecutor even said that there are some communications that it's not only about extrajudicial killings as part of the crimes against humanity, but there's possibility of torture as well as the arbitrary detention. For members of the family, it's like the palit-ulo. If they don't get to see the suspect in the war on drugs at home, then they would get a family member to be detained, or maybe to force him or her to speak about the whereabouts of that suspect user or peddler of drugs. But that's not within the rule of law. Mm-hmm. So you can't just get somebody to replace somebody you're looking for. And there has to be, in fact, if you detain, there has to be that order of the court for that person to be arrested and detained.
Mm-hmm. And Doc, the ICC prosecutor in requesting to resume the probe has mentioned that the investigations in the Philippines did not amount to a criminal prosecution. That's one of the points he's saying. And also that it did not reach high-level officials, including the president, who was quoted to have goaded or encouraged the killings. Now, are you seeing any indications under this administration that they are open to investigating former President Duterte now that he has no longer has presidential immunity?
President Marcos ran with Sara Duterte, who's now our vice president, and she's a daughter of the former president, who might possibly be charged if the investigation will continue, if there is some pieces of evidence that they think would point to the president as one who's encouraged or emboldened people to kill, then it's in the interest of this duo, the president and the vice president, not to have genuine investigations locally. And, in our justice system also, usually it's only the direct perpetrator who is filed a case and then convicted. In the case of Kian de los Santos, those who pulled the trigger, the police, were convicted, and but we don't have anyone who may be guilty of command responsibility for all mm-hmm. these killings. So mm-hmm. The truth is, first, if the Philippine government will really genuinely investigate, then it should not stop with only those who pull the trigger. Secondly, it should in fact look at possible regional leaders who might have command responsibility, or even now Senator Bato de la Rosa, who was the Philippine National Police Chief during when the war on drugs started, and subsequent police chief who might have a command responsibility in the killings, because killings of this amount, those related to the police operations, is about 6,000, 7,000. And those outside, supposedly, of the police operations, there's estimates of like about 30,000 being killed. But there are some pieces of information already provided to the police and to the media and to the International Criminal Court that there were cases of police operation, of non-official police operations, but that policemen who were in civilian clothes were there to clear up the place before non-police elements go there, and which resulted to killing. So there's a lot that has to be investigated really by the law enforcement agencies. First, the police. Second, the NBI, if it goes into some cases. And then, of course, there has already been reports of the IAS, Internal Affairs Services of the PNP, that there is violation of the protocols, which Sol Jen Guevara himself recognized. So there are many information already that's there that they should really look into, have genuine investigation, whether it is already with the ICC, information is already, communication has already been with the ICC, or even outside the ICC, cases that were brought to them. So for instance, because of the withdrawal of the Philippines from the Rome Statute, effective March 16, 2019, then any extrajudicial killing during the war on drugs will not be taken on by the ICC. It is only when we were still part of the ICC that cases can be investigated. But what is good is that the ICC took note that there had been campaigns of against drugs in Davao in 2011. And since the Philippines has been a party of the court during that time under President Aquino, then those possible crimes in Davao should also be investigated. And that was noted by the ICC prosecutor. There's no investigation of the Davao cases from 2011. Which is covered by the ICC. We were a part of the ICC then. And secondly, basically the report of Justice Guevara, now Sol Jen Guevara, was a desk review of what has been investigated, but what actions have they done? Did they, did they now give, you know, file charges, criminal cases, not just administrative, and even those police doctors. I'm a medical doctor, and it's really for me, for a doctor to put natural cause as cause of death for people who were killed through gunshot wounds and in the head. That's really against professional ethics of the doctor, not to do harm. It's not about treatment, but you should not do harm when people are killed extrajudicially, and that is, they have a right to remedy. And a doctor should not be an obstacle to the efforts to seek justice and make people accountable for crimes against humanity of murder and possibly detention and torture.
Now, Doc, let's talk about the involvement of former presidential advisor Harry Roque. The president said he was consulted because of his expertise in international law. Attorney Roque himself said he was retained as private counsel of the president. Is there a need for the president to retain a legal counsel when he is not himself a party or is not the subject of the ICC's probe?
I don't know. You know, the president is not... cannot be possibly charged by the ICC. The crimes that are being investigated by the ICC were during President Duterte's time. And we have withdrawn from the ICC. So anything that he does in the war on drugs cannot be taken on by the ICC. Mm-hmm. But I'm really very sad that he now thinks that he needs a counsel, and is that an ominous sign that there will be possibilities of really continuing the war on drugs that kills and contribute to possible crimes against humanity? Of course, even if the ICC cannot take it on, because we're not a party now, but there is a domestic law which can look at cases of crimes against humanity, genocide, and war crimes, because we have, to a certain extent, copied what was in the Rome Statute when we passed that law against international humanitarian law crimes, international concern.
Now, Doc, Attorney Roque was a former co-chairperson of your group, the Philippine Coalition for the ICC. So how is your group taking his position now on the ICC issue? And talk to us about the long journey that your group fought for us to join, for the country to join the ICC in 2011.
Yes. In fact, we started campaigning for the ICC even before it started, the court itself. We were party, the Philippine Coalition for the ICC and its members, like Amnesty International, Task Force Detainees of the Philippines, the Medical Action Group, and so many other human rights organizations were a party to the campaign for the establishment of the court first, and then secondly, for the Philippines to ratify. It took us about 10 years to really campaign for it because President Estrada signed it, but the subsequent presidents did not want to give it to the Senate for ratification. So it was only when we had Philippine President Aquino, who recognized the possibility that in some cases, the domestic processes might not be able or unwilling to prosecute and render justice to victims of crimes against humanity, genocide, war crimes, and the crimes of aggression. So he had it processed. He gave it to the Senate, and the Senate immediately ratified it, because at that time we had already convinced many of our senators that it is into our interest that we join the ICC. You know, when President Marcos said that he will not rejoin the ICC, he is depriving people of a court of last resort for those serious crimes. And even our problem at the West Philippine Sea, because crime of aggression is included. And so that's a possible area for accountability. With regards to Attorney Roque, it's really, how do you say, initially we were shocked. But then he was consistent about saying that the ICC should not have a jurisdiction with the ICC because the courts are functioning. But he knows, no? So that there's no good investigation, no genuine investigation that goes to criminal prosecution, and that we are within the jurisdiction of the court while we were a party to it. He knows that. So he's just denying many things that he knows as a lawyer.
Mm-hmm. Lastly, Doc Aup, we don't have much time, but what do we stand to lose if we don't rejoin the ICC? And what's the danger if the Philippines ignores the ICC probe?
If the Philippine government ignores the ICC probe, the ICC can still continue to investigate in various ways. You know, mm-hmm. There are open information about the cases. So they can look at the report of Dr. Fortun and all these NGOs, as well as the Commission on Human Rights. So there's that possibility that the probe will continue and there can be possible warrants of arrest and trial, even without the support of the current government now. Because mm-hmm. maybe there's a possibility that we have a better government that will cooperate with the ICC in future. Second, mm-hmm. if they will not rejoin, then, like I said, we are depriving the people of the possibility of a court of last resort when the processes in the country fail us to give justice to the victims and their families. And when states, for instance, possibly commit a crime of aggression against our country.
Mm-hmm. All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning and for sharing your insights. Dr. Aurora Parong, co-chairperson of the Philippine Coalition for the ICC.
Thank you very much, Mike. And thank you very much, Niti.